This is How to Adult First Aid and CPR Edition. I'm going to show you a few things that could help if you were ever in an emergency situation. We'll start with CPR and then move on to cuts, burns, and other illnesses. First thing we're going to go over is CPR. So CPR keeps the blood pumping to the brain to ensure that the brain is getting enough oxygen and it's able to survive. For every 1 minute that the body goes without CPR, that's a 10% decrease in survival rate. So if you do the math there, that's about 10 minutes that the body can go without oxygen. Otherwise, the survival rate is not likely. Okay, so if somebody is unconscious, you're going to check, see if they respond. There's no response. So go ahead and call 911 and look, listen, and feel for breathing. So you can do this by tilting the head, looking for the chest to rise, and you're feeling and listening around the mouth for any breath sounds. Okay, you're going to do this for about 5 seconds, and if you do not hear breathing, you're going to start CPR. You should find the hard, flat section in the middle of the chest, pull your fingers up off of their chest, lock your elbows, and push down about 2 inches. You're going to push down hard and fast continuously until help arrives. If while you're doing CPR, you start to see any signs of life, any movement or breathing, you can roll them over on your side. And monitor them for continued signs of life. If anything changes, you would just roll them back over and continue CPR. There's no need to count because you're not going to be giving breaths. Unless you have a mask or you've been trained otherwise, you're going to do hands-only CPR, and that's going to help pump some of the oxygen to the brain. If you suspect that somebody is choking, you're going to ask them, are you choking? Can you breathe? Are you choking? If they're not able to respond, their airway may be blocked. So you're going to ask them if you can help. Is it okay if I help you? If they nod yes, you are going to go ahead and try to help. So you're going to stick one arm underneath theirs, across their chest, and lean their body forward. From there, you give 5 hard back blows right in the middle of the shoulder blades, and then 5 abdominal thrusts just above the belly button. You want to go in and up, and you will continue to rotate through those cycles until they are able to breathe or they become unconscious and you begin doing CPR. As soon as you suspect somebody is choking and you notice that their airway is blocked, call 911 first, because if you are not able to get the airway open, that's precious time that you've lost. For cuts, make sure you apply direct pressure. And if it bleeds through the cloth, instead of removing it, which could break up the clot and cause it to bleed more, you're just going to add on more layers. Apply direct pressure, and if you're not able to get it to stop, you may need to seek immediate care for stitches or other closures. If you have a burn, make sure you remove it from the source and run it under cold water for about 30 to 60 seconds. You should avoid ice or any other solutions or vinegar or creams to put over it. That can sometimes make the burns worse. And make sure that if it blisters, you're not picking at it or poking or pulling the skin off, because that could open it up for some infections and it can scar later. If somebody has an injury, you don't want to move the body part at all. If you absolutely have to move them or you have to transport them to a hospital, you could use something like bubble wrap or a cardboard and splint the body part as you found it. Again, don't straighten it out or move it in any way. The other option is to use their body. So if you are just able to use their chest to splint it, or maybe their other leg or their other hand, and just give them as much support as possible. Books work really good for this. Blankets, towels, anything that can give it a little bit of support that are able to mold around that body part without you having to move it too much. If somebody does have an injury and they start to feel nauseous or lightheaded, or they look really pale or acting very confused, those are signs of shock. You need to call 911. Don't try to transport them to the hospital themselves because they could lose consciousness. So make sure that they're comfortable. Loosen up any tight clothing. You can give them a cool rag. Again, don't give them anything to eat or drink, because if they go unconscious, you are not able to, or it could cause choking. And call 911 and wait for them to arrive. If you suspect that somebody is having a stroke, you want to think fast. F stands for face, so any numbness or drooping of the face. A stands for arms, if they're having any numbness or weakness in their arms. S stands for speech, so are they able to talk to you, answer questions, or are they slurring their speech? And T stands for time. As soon as you suspect a stroke, you need to call 911 and document the time that those symptoms started. Those are going to help them get care and as quickly as possible. Signs of a heart attack can be kind of confusing because a lot of people experience different symptoms. The main common symptoms that you may experience are chest pain, shortness of breath, difficulty breathing, nausea, vomiting, and profuse sweating. If you suspect that anybody is having a heart attack, do not give them anything to eat or drink. Sit them in a cool, comfortable position, hopefully on the ground, so if they are to go unconscious, you're able to give them CPR without having to move them. And loosen up any tight clothing. So you loosen up clothing, you could get them a cool rag, and just make sure they feel as comfortable as possible until EMS arrives. You enjoyed CPR and first aid today. It's always better to call for help when you need it than to not have help on the way and realize you need it 10 or 15 minutes later. So the sooner you can get